I didn't want you to know what I went through. Because then you're gonna say, oh my God, look what she went through, and you're gonna be hurt. So Daddy says, the only way you can do that is if you take the past, put it in an iron box, and lock it. And you cannot talk about it.
So it was Dad's idea for you not to tell us?
Yes. Dad was a smart man.
I don't know if that was so smart. But that was Dad.
It's hard to say.
I didn't know that. I thought you decided. I thought that was your...
No, that was his decision. But suggestion. I didn't want to talk to you about it.
We were seven kids, and I was the sixth one. I had a very, very good life. My parents were loving. My father made a good living, but we had a bacha store. But still, there wasn't enough money to buy toys. I was in first grade, and I liked playing hopscotch, I remember, because there were no dolls or anything to play with. Most of the people were non-Jewish, and anything that was going on, you know, like a marriage, whatever, it took place in the synagogue. We had a beautiful new synagogue made out of stone. The food was okay because they used a lot of dairy stuff. We had one cow, I remember one cow. So we had plenty butter, cheese. I remember smelling that dairy stuff. I had a little brother that I loved so much. He loved reading, and if I would read to him my book, he would be sitting near me so close and just listen and listen. Businesses were taken away when the Hungarians came in. I just tell you about a small little incident. I ran to get myself ice cream. When I got to the store, so takes one look at me and he says he can't give me ice cream because I'm Jewish. As a little girl, I didn't know what he was talking about, and I came home crying. And I told him, I know his children, I played with them, and all of a sudden I'm Jewish. It's like I have a disease. When the Hungarians came in, we Jews went to the same school. We had the same teachers. And of course, to us, education was number one, especially my father. So we came home and we said, you know, we did our homework and put our hand up, and they just don't call on us anymore. So my father was very upset. So he went and got a Jewish teacher. And we gave him, you know, room and board. We didn't go to public school anymore. But after a while, all the Jewish kids used to come to our house. And our house became a school, and my grandfather's house became a shul. Then the Germans came in altogether. That's when our end was. They didn't waste too much time because we had to put a Magenduvet in our house, and we had to wear clothes with a Magenduvet. We couldn't go out to shop, you know, 6 o'clock, and by 6 o'clock, there wasn't anything in the stores. But we didn't think they're going to ship us out to a destruction camp. So one day, they came and told all the Jews should, you know, pack up, and they're going on a farm, and they're going to work. And then they'll come back. We had to go to a square. Then, with pickup trucks, they took us to Ujhara, the capital city of Carpathia. And that's where we were, in the ghetto.
Most of the time, I mean, every Thursday. So if somebody comes over and asks me questions, I tell them, this is what it is. This is what it was. We came in the transport, and we are there. And we're coming. We had to take this little valise into the ditch, you know, there was a... So everybody was doing it. But my grandfather, he didn't want to throw down the Torah because he said it was a sin. My mother saw that that monster was telling him to throw it down and he didn't want to. He was trying to explain him that it's a sin to throw that Torah scroll on. Well, he didn't listen to my mother either. And they were beating him and beating him. Until he fell. They were telling us to go to the right. My mother, my sister, and my mother was holding my brother. You see, this is my brother, my little brother. He was 6 years old. My mother noticed that he had a book. She was scared that if he's not gonna throw down the book, that he's gonna get beaten up. So my mother started negotiating with him that, you know, he should throw the book down. And being 6 years old, he didn't understand why he needs to do that. So he, finally my mother got the book from him and he gave it to my mother and my mother threw it in the ditch and he started crying. A monster came over and he was trying to pull him away from my mother. And my mother wouldn't let it go. And you know, he was stronger, that monster. He pulled him away, my brother was crying, and my mother ran and ran after them. And she got beaten up. She got beaten up. And they kicked her around with those big boots. I sometimes wish I could forget it because it's so painful and I'm carrying it around in my heart for so many years. My mother left with my brother. When I got liberated, you know, my mind crossed. If maybe if she would have run after my brother, maybe she would have survived. But I'll tell you the truth. I don't think she would have survived all the difficulties we had to endure. They finally separated us, the men and the women and the young people. My mother told us to take care of each other.
my sister went with my grandma. You know, she was holding on to her. And so they just left to the left, and I only remember seeing them just going to the left. Otherwise, I didn't see them anymore because, you know, all the old people and the kids were going to the left. After a while, it was dark. As they were taking us, you know, going to the gas chambers into the showers, it was the same way. There were gorgeous flowers and trees. And in the background, they had music playing. Because of the 6 million Jews. This is Auschwitz, thank you. Birkenau was part of it. My whole family, my dear family, I hope you know that I'm here. And I remember you.
I knew that something terrible happened. I knew that I didn't have a grandmother and a grandfather. And I remember very clearly, you got a book, it was about Hitler, and you were reading the book, it was near your bedside, and you had torn out the eyes from him.
Really?
Yeah.
You know, I don't
remember. You don't remember that?
Yeah.
You had one, Eichmann, you did the same thing, and one called Women of the Swastika that you did something to the cover?
I don't remember.
Yeah. You know, it was clear that you were not happy a lot of the time.
No. You know, this just doesn't leave you, maybe because I was so young and witnessing it, really. If I would witness it, maybe I could, but horrible things.
I remember this was one of the darkest days that I can remember in my life. Mom was in bed for days and...
For days?
For days, crying, talking about her father and her mother, and, you know, it was like she was having a nightmare, but she was awake. And I remember you were young, Michelle went into the bedroom, and I dealt with it. And at one point, one day, Dad was at home, and I said, "Dad, you have to help. You have to help Mom. She's sick. It's terrible." And he got angry, and he just left.
I think if I would have talked to you, it would be worse, because you would be bitter people what they did to my mother. You would be angry.
I was angry.
Yeah, yeah.
You were angry.
Of course.
At who?
Well, once we found out.
What?
I said, once we found out, you couldn't keep it a secret forever.
No, when, right.
It was okay, Mom.
I did the best I knew.
You did very well. And you have a big family now to show for doing so well.
And I tell you one thing. I knew that my kids were raised with all the love I had in me. That I can say.
They got about maybe 2,000 girls. They cut our hair. And they told us to undress. were naked. And you know, we were sort of normal yet because we were coming from home. I remember I was just looking down, staying there, and the Germans were going back and forth, and it was like seeing a theater for them. You know, they were laughing, entertaining each other. And then they gave us a striped dress and wooden cloths in a bowl. And they told us we should march. We marched and marched. They got us into a barrack. I was here on top. Six girls were sleeping, one of those.
So did you lie on your side?
You couldn't turn over. You know, if you turned over, everybody had to turn over. I looked out and I saw people hanging from the electric wires. People, you know, they were trying to escape. And then we got just caught on the electric wire and they got electrocuted. So I told my sister, Sylvia, this is, something's not right here. And she said to me, well, when we'll go out tomorrow, we'll see what will happen. But there were a lot of people on these electric wires. They didn't take these people off because they were trying to tell the rest of the people, don't try it, you're not going to make it. We were there in that barrack, not for too long.
Then the Germans
needed it, workers. I worked in a munition factory. We had to walk from where our barrack was into the munition factory. Sometimes it was cold and our clothes would go into the snow. So if somebody found some rope to tie that cloth to the foot, he was lucky. The kids that worked during the day, it was easier for them, because they opened up the doors and the windows and they could breathe some fresh air. But at night, they were afraid they're gonna be bombed. Mm. So the doors and the windows were closed and the air got completely poisoned. So what happened was our eyes got yellow, you know, the skin got yellow. We didn't look like human beings. And a lot of them were fainting and dying anyway, the weaker ones.
Hello, darkness.
Now, this neighborhood was different than the one we live in now, because we were neighbors. We had, you know, my parents were friends with all of the people around here. And I had a friend around the corner that I could go to his house. Remember the Maisies?
Yes.
Maisie, even when I was 5 years old, I could go by myself.
And the vision that was planted in my brain.
We must have had satyrs here.
Yeah, I always had satyrs. Nobody else wanted to be stuck with it. But I always had the biggest house, the biggest place. So.
And you could cook?
Yeah, I cooked.
When I had you kids, I was very happy to be with you. I never wanted to leave you. Some parents want to leave their children to relax. I'm relaxed, you know. I yell at you a little bit. Did I yell a lot?
No.
You just cried.
Cried.
That's worse.
Do you remember ever moving from being depressed all the time to happy?
Yeah, I think when I had your kids, I felt that I got something of my own. I got something of my own. that I lost everybody that I love. Now I have three people that I love, you know.
In the museum, everybody's asking me, well, how do you have children? How are they? And how did you raise them? Some people think that I was not capable of raising kids. Here you are, beautiful and everything. And okay, smart.
Okay. Well, I could testify to the fact that you raised three children very well. I don't think the meanness that you were treated to, you then passed along. So that might be a misconception some people have, is that, you know, if you're treated in an evil way, do you become an evil person? And that certainly wasn't the case for you at all. I felt we were extremely fortunate that we were showed compassion and love and care. We were made to feel special and unique, and that's the positive, maybe, if there is such a thing. We felt very treasured and very important to both you and Deb.
Coincidence that Aunt Rose and Aunt Mishy and I all went into professions that we saw as helping professions, as tikkun olam, helping to repair the world, whether it's medicine. Aunt Rose got a PhD in biology and did research, and Aunt Mishy is a psychologist. We all felt that helping make the world a better place was our mission.
Finally, after a while, they bombed the factory. The SS left us, and people came from civilian clothes with a pickup truck.
But the Nazis had left a terrible legacy. When they saw the German concentration camps, men toughened by combat were sickened by the sights and smells and the cruelties that had been committed. Men and women, girls and boys, were starved, beaten, tortured, and finally burnt. And the living prayed for death.
It was maybe an hour's ride or something. And they got us, and we saw it said Bergen-Belsen. They opened the door, and there was dead ones, because they weren't feeding in. They didn't let them out. You could die just from the smell. And we looked around, and there was no place to sit down, because everything was so filthy and dirty, and people were crazy and bad. My sister got sick first, and they took her away. I said, well, I have to go and look for her. So I started to go and look for her, and I must have fainted. I looked like a skeleton, but I had a heartbeat. I don't remember who picked me up, you know, I was really out. And then, of course, they took me to this makeshift hospital, and I was laying there, and they were trying to keep me alive, you know, like feeding me through vein, because I couldn't eat. A few days passed by, I was looking for my sister's face. Well, she wasn't there, and I was sure she died. I just collapsed, and I just cried. And a nurse comes over, she says to me, you know, your sister is alive, but she's very ill, she's very sick. As soon as she feels better, we'll bring her here. And finally, they did bring her. She felt better.
The Swedish Red Cross took out 600 girls from the hospitals.
and we were chosen to go to sleep. They put us in a sanitarium. They put our names in the Brooklyn paper, and my sister found us in the Brooklyn, not her actually, her friend found us. And 4 months later, we came to the United States. This is Larry when he became a doctor. And my gorgeous Jessica, I love her.
The Holocaust has not only affected the first generation, the generation that actually went through the tragedies and the horrific experiences of World War II, but the next generation and the third generation. In our family, it's also affected them in a positive connection towards Israel. We all feel very, very committed to the survival and the strength of the state of Israel.
First time we came to Israel, and I was 10 years old on a boat from Italy, and we all got up at 5 in the morning so that we could see the coast coming into view and slowly seeing Haifa as we got closer and closer, and Grandpa and Grandma were, you know, for them it was like the second coming. it was nothing short of a miracle.
You saw that, you know, even from the survivors, that there was, that you need to protect Israel and you need to be around. So that's one of the huge reasons that I came and joined the army. And since I told her that's what I was doing, and since she's seen me in uniform, or she's seen me, heard stories about my experience or whatever, she kind of, at the same time, she taught, you see that she's proud and that she's very happy, and that she knows that it's what needs to happen. She, at the same time, says she wishes that we didn't, none of her family had to do it.
You helped me show the connection between Grandma and Israel a great deal, so you can see how when family members pick up on the importance between Israel's significance and Grandma's experiences that exemplify how incredibly important it is, they can pass those on to their family members. So I feel like as long as I can like explain the significance of Grandma's experiences and how Israel's connected, then I'll be able to pass that on to my family members in the future as well.
We in America are immigrants, or the children of immigrants. Millions of Europeans left their homeland to settle in new countries across the seas. Almost two-thirds of them came to the United States. Sprawling communities of transplanted peoples, living side by side, but still diverse in languages and customs, as diverse as these shop signs that mark the immigrant neighborhoods. The newspapers that spoke to the immigrants in languages they knew. The trade unions that taught them to work together. These and other agencies drew into the larger community the stream of new arrivals.
For a job. Of course, I couldn't get a job. I wasn't trained in anything. My brother-in-law told me that there is a big, big place they make furs. He says, well, go up there. Maybe, you know, you can do something there. I came into the office, and Mr. Morgenstern takes a look at me. I told him who I am. I tell them I'm a survivor, and I live with my sister, and she can't afford her. I have to get a job. So he takes a look at me, says, honey, I don't have a job for you. But being that my brother-in-law said it's such a big place, I saw a door and I sneaked into the factory.
when I sneaked into the factory, there were so many people. I said, for so many people, there was no place for me. There was his father, and I told him the story. So he goes over to this young Mr. Morgenstern. You got to give her a job. So after a while, he came and told me, come back tomorrow. It was a lady. So the lady takes a look at me. You know, I didn't wear makeup and nothing. My hair was bushy, I had so much hair. A scarecrow. So anyway, she says to me, Helen, we're going shopping. I said, listen, there's a problem. I don't have no money. So she says, don't worry, don't worry. The factory will take care of it. She took to the boutique and she brings these dresses. They're $50, $60. I said, can't you find something cheaper? She puts this dress on me. And I take a look at myself. I had to take twice whether that's me. You know, I myself wasn't ready to look like a person, you know, like a young lady.
Right.
I had to go to the beauty parlor every week. That was my job. All of a sudden, the models are not coming in. So they figured out maybe they should make me for a model. So they were sending me to modeling school. After 4 months being here, my sister says, go to New York. You know, everybody likes to see New York.
Bubbles, bingos, your howdy ding-a-ding-a-ling-a. Bubbles, bingos, bright shine.
All of a sudden, we hear music. So they say, oh, let's go in and see what this music is about. Well, there were young kids having a good time.
Bingos and beer.
Maybe 10, 15 minutes later, kids approaches me, your father. Says to me, do you want to dance? I says, no, I don't dance. Do you want to drink? No,
I don't drink either.
He already saw that I'm a strange bird, that I didn't speak real English. Then he wanted to know my story. And he kept on asking me. And I didn't want to tell him because I knew I'm going to cry. He wanted 6 kids. You crazy? I told him I don't want to marry him. I'm never going to have 6 kids. I'm going to have one.
My heart was singing, wearing baubles, bangles, and beads.
Dad was very restless. He was very smart. He did well, I think. He came here, he had $7.
Make somebody.
He was buying army clothes and selling it from the Chinese.
Buy me a ring, a ring, a ring.
He wasn't that business until he got a few dollars. And then he bought little houses. He had it fixed up and resold it and then made money again. He traveled a lot because Daddy was a person that wanted to know everything, he wanted to touch everything. And when we traveled, I think we were both happier. Because look what I raised. I had my sad days, but I also had my wonderful days when you kids were born. That was wonderful.
I saw that there was a possibility that things in the world could be terrible for sort of some people, even if you don't see it in front of your face all the time. And it's easier to believe that those things are happening. Grandma has such a belief in God and such a belief in positiveness and actually the great aspects of humankind. And then it makes me feel like I have an obligation to do positive things.
So good to see you.
She's been able to fight through the most difficult struggles that humankind's seen in the last several centuries, and anything I go through, thinking about her makes me stronger, and thinking about how strong she is makes me stronger.
I feel like I would call myself a third generation Holocaust survivor. Like I'm a survivor in a way, because she is, and I'm her granddaughter. And the experience of the Holocaust, what it made me realize is the importance of empathy. I always am conscious of the need to think of people as not different from me, really, because of any racial or ethnic or religious differences, because I know that that's how part of how the Holocaust was allowed to happen.
I'll try and come and see you maybe in the spring, when it's gonna be warmer here. And I hope I'll see the new baby too in the spring.
Yeah, in the spring we should have a new one for you.
Yeah, okay.